and welcome back to my channel and Crystal One on One. We are settled and comfy at the patio, a fantastic restaurant and lounge in Bokoto. You have to come if you haven't been. And today I'm excited to talk to someone who just has a great vibe about him always. You know him on TV as a media personality, Subi Ngobi Douglas, better known as Dougie Nice, joins me today on Crystal One on One.
Yay!
Yeah!
What's up?
Welcome.
Thank you.
How are you?
I'm good.
Uh-huh.
How have you been?
I've been good.
Let me tell you something before we even get started. I've always wanted to be with you on this.
Oh.
And look where I am right now. Like, yeah.
It was overdue. It was overdue.
I know.
Mm-hmm.
I'm so excited.
So Dougie Nice from Douglas.
Yes.
How did we get Dougie Nice? Your best man gave you that nickname, right?
Yes. Yes. Uh-huh. Yes. This is a story I've told like a million times.
Mm-hmm.
I've always been one of Chameleon's closest people from way back in the day. And way before, you know, I got into this whole stardom thing and TV and all that, I used to be like a wingman.
Ah.
Yeah, so I was one of those boys that, you know, Dougie, can you go pick the kids from school? Yes. Dougie, would you go get me some food from? Yes. Dougie, I forgot these shoes. Would you jump on a bike to go back home? Yes. Dougie, my perfume, let me go get it. Dougie, Daniela wants to do it. Would you do? I'll do it. So I was more like his yes man.
Mm.
And one day we was just chilling and he wanted to send me back to Segugu and we were already in town. And the wife, Daniela, said, no, don't disturb him. We can do it another time. And he said, guy Wangi, this is my nice guy. He will go. Dougie Nice, are you not my nice guy? I was like,
and it just came out like that.
Yeah, like Dougie Nice, are you not my nice guy? Told you, I said, no, I'm cool. I can just go. He said, oh, this is my nice guy. And just like that, everybody started calling me Dougie Nice, Dougie Nice, Dougie Nice.
Okay, so this is way before TV and all
yeah,
of that.
Yeah, 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 way before TV.
So you said you have been friends for a very long time.
Yes.
Is this from school days or was this later in life?
No, from entertainment days. You know, interestingly enough, the very first time that I came super up close with Chameleon is the year that Akon came to Uganda.
Oh, okay.
At that time, I was working at a club called Sway for Rajiv Uparelia.
Uh-huh, I remember Sway.
I was a barman.
Okay.
More like a cleaner, really, but behind the bar.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, organizing bottles and glasses and washing and cups and plates and those things. But then I already had the passion for entertainment. So when we was not busy, I would go on the microphone.
Mm-hmm.
This is like after lunch, when the club is quiet. Super empty and quiet. So I'd be on the microphone and be like, yo, today we're going to, microphone check, 1, 2, I know all those things. When the DJs are, you know, really doing the sound check. So one day I was doing that and Rajiv walked in with a couple of friends. And I'd never noticed. We were just in the booth playing. Rajiv walked in, went to office, did his accounting and stuff, and they walked out and they stood there and they were just looking at me, making a lot of noise.
And you weren't aware? You didn't know they were paying any attention to you?
Not at all. I was just, yo, well done, no word, done. And then after Rajiv was like, you know how to speak.
Okay.
You know how to talk. I was like, I am so fired. I was like, I'm so sorry, sir. He said, no, I like it. Tonight, you're not working behind the bar. Tonight, you're working with the DJ's booth. I was like, no. I was like, no, I'll go back to the counter. He said, no.
You start tonight. So it wasn't even something you wanted to do? You were just having fun?
Yeah, you know, like you see Crystal and you adore Crystal and you emulate Crystal, and when Crystal is out of office, you go to Crystal's machines and say, hey, what's up, my name's Crystal Newman. And then this one day Crystal walks in and
like, hey, there's something there.
Just decides to watch you.
Mm.
And that's how it all began, like my microphone journey. And then I started emceeing at Sway, slowly by slowly, and then I gained confidence, and then I started owning nights there. And then Akon comes to town and Rajiv says, you shall be hosting Akon, the meet and greet.
Mm-hmm.
Long story short, Chameleon comes through, and he wasn't on the list of the invited people, but Chameleon, being the biggest artist in the land, of course. So I walk over to the VIP entrance with the microphone and I say, hey yo, Akon, guess what? Guess who just walked in? The biggest artist we have in the country, Dr. Chameleon, you ought to meet this guy. And then he walks in and then he has this attention, then they hug and then they do, and then I kill a minute and I'm busy introducing him again. This right here is the biggest artist in East Africa, Akon. So Akon was wondering, this
like, who's this guy? Who's this guy?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So after their banter, after the big party, Chameleon calls me and says, what's your name? I said, my name is Douglas. I like you. You should be my friend. Call me.
He chose you as his friend.
He said, you should be my friend. Call me. I never slept that night. True story. And I'm sticking to my story.
Uh-huh.
I never slept that night. I said, Chameleon, give me his number. And I started looking for him. I never found him for like the next 14 days. And then after like 14 days, I bumped into him again. Mm-hmm. He came by the club. I said, I tried to call you today. He said, Mbadengola tour. But I'm back. You should come and join me. And that's how I started hanging with Chameleon.
Okay.
Yeah.
So it sounds like opportunities just kind of presented themselves and you just took them.
Absolutely.
Okay, so take me back. Ugandan, born, raised here.
Oh, yes.
Where?
Yes. Actually, this is a story that has always baffled me a lot. So, my passport reads Ugandan,
mm-hmm.
clearly.
Yeah.
And then this one time, I was renewing my passport. And over at the passport office, the lady that was working on me was looking at me because I was putting on a very small T-shirt. And the lady said, but are you Ugandan? First time I ever had that kind of question. I was like, what do you mean, am I Ugandan?
Like, why would you even ask me that?
And the lady did point at my immunization spot.
Okay.
Little did I know that, you know, if you was born
so it's, in... So it's not here?
No, it's here. If you were born in Kenya, they immunize you right here. Right here. I'll show you. Were you born here?
I was born in Nairobi.
You see? Wow! You see? Mm-hmm. So I was like, what do you mean? He was like, you don't even know.
Aww.
I was like, I don't know.
Did you ever ask anyone about it? I mean,
yeah, so I did ask my dad. I was like, so at the passport office, the lady told me something about this.
Mm-hmm.
And my dad was like, you were born in Kisumu, but...
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
So I was like, I've never heard about that my whole entire life. It was like, yeah, you were born in Kisumu. I was working in Kenya those days. So you were born in Kisumu, but, you know, after about a year or two.
And then you came back.
Yeah. I came back as a baby.
Okay. Like, so where is your birth certificate? I should be asking you that then.
Ugandan. Ugandan, 100%.
Okay. Well, we don't even remember what happens like before a year. So, okay.
That's all I've known.
So from Kisumu, you're born there, now you know?
Yeah.
You come back to Uganda, where did you settle? Where did you grow up?
Jinja. I'm a Jinja boy.
Oh.
Yeah.
Aren't you lucky? I feel like slightly envious of people who grew up in Jinja.
How's that?
I think it's... From the sound of it, it was just a nice place to grow up.
It was a fun place to grow up.
Hmm.
It was a fun place. It was more like a community-based place to grow.
Mm-hmm.
More like family.
Mm-hmm.
People would know each other within the smallest, you know, vicinities.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, families would own families. Like, Crystal, you would be, like, responsible for, like, another 10 families. Like, you'd find someone's child and you'd have authority over them.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that kind of thing.
Mm-hmm.
It was really lovely.
Okay.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
He was.
So school there as well?
Yes. Mwiri Primary. Mm-hmm. All 7 years. Actually, my whole family, I think we all went through Mwiri.
Okay.
Yeah. I think my dad had a thing for Mwiri. Up to today, I don't know why.
You all went through.
Somehow.
So how many siblings are we talking about?
We are 8 in the family. Mm-hmm. 5 boys and 3 girls.
5 boys and 3 girls.
And I'm the last boy.
Last boy.
I am boy number 5.
Boy number 5. And
yeah.
Number out of 8?
And I'm boy number 5.
Uh-huh.
And all the 3 girls come after me.
Wait. 5 boys, yeah. Then 3 girls?
Yes.
Wow. Okay.
I still wonder how he did it. Looks like it was programmed.
No mixing up?
No.
I wonder what changed.
5 straight boys and 3 girls.
Okay.
Yeah.
So were you protective of your sisters then?
Still I am to today.
You are?
Yeah.
You? Yeah, because you're like the big brother.
Yeah. Still I am to today. And you know, amazingly, I am the last boy, but looks like I am the one they are afraid of the most.
Okay, why?
I have no idea. But my friends tell me, my friends who are their friends, our cousins, they say, those girls don't feel super comfy around you. I'm always thinking, why?
That's what I'm saying. Maybe big brother, you like growing up, you were like.
Yet these other ones are super cool with them.
Okay.
Yeah.
So would you consider that like you are a principled, strict person? Is there anything to you like that?
I think because I'm the closest to them. I think we had so many fights. I felt like I had an authority over them because I was the closest to them.
Mm.
And I spent a lot of time with them at home as opposed to the boys that came before me.
Maybe they were in boarding school or they were older.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So I don't know. I just don't know.
It's interesting.
Yeah. Mm?
You should tell your brother why. Why he scares you a bit. So high school, where did you go?
Busega College, Mwiri. After Mwiri, I got fired. Then I went to Crested Crane.
There was a drama.
Yeah.
Why?
Then I went to Crested Crane in Makindye, and then I went to Makere.
Okay. Why the drama?
You know, boys being boys.
What does that mean?
Boys being boys.
What does that mean?
Largely part of my drama was escaping from school.
Mm-hmm.
Now the neighboring school across Mwiri is called Waraka College.
Okay.
And it has a lake.
Mm-hmm.
So we used to escape to go and swim. and then part of the reasons why we would like to go swimming is because Waraka College is a mixed school.
So that's where the girls were.
So that's where the girls were. Most of the times, lots of them would go and do their washing there and the laundry and stuff. So,
What else can I say? Okay. So, like you said,
I'm saying the of the eye, of the eye, Crystal.
I don't know what you're saying.
Respect the pandemic.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yes, full respect.
Yeah. Yes, so it was just for the eye.
Totally PG thoughts here.
Yeah, just for the eye.
Mm. Mm-hmm. Okay, okay. Yeah. So when were you expelled?
In senior three.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and then.
Were you with your dad at that point? How did he take it?
You're still in Kenya.
Okay.
So mm-hmm. we were under the care of an uncle.
Okay.
Yeah, who was also very tough. It was called Uncle Fred.
Mm.
So, but, you know, took it in.
Okay.
Looked for another school for me, and I flipped the switch.
Okay.
Yeah.
So after that, you settled? Did you make a conscious choice to settle, or were
still... Oh, yes, I did. I did. Quite distinctively, I did.
Okay. Yeah. And your mom?
Now, my mom, I'll tell you something amazing. I have grown up without knowing my mom.
Okay.
Yeah, she left me when I was in P2, P3, separated with my dad, and she left for the UK, lived in the UK for close to about 12 years. Mm. And then she made the switch to the United States. Ever since, she's been living there up to today.
Okay.
Yeah, so from that time, up to close to about 2016, 17,
mm-hmm.
I never made eye contact. I didn't even know she was alive. I didn't even know nothing.
Okay.
Like nothing, absolute nothing. So one time I was just having lunch with a friend of mine, and I did mention to that friend of mine who's called Brian Walusimbi, and I said to him, you know, I've been told my mom is a pastor because Brian is a very strong Christian.
Okay.
So he was always asking me, but Dad, you know, you were a church boy. What happened to your stuff? And I was like, you know, somehow I lost faith in church and those things. He said, but why? I've really wanted to know why. I said, you know, I've been told my mom is a pastor. She's been a pastor for the longest while. But
had you just found out? Because you said at first you didn't even know she was alive. How did you find out about her?
Like, people that lived in the UK were sharing stories that your mom is a pastor. Your mom traveled to the US. Now she's a big time pastor, and you should endeavor to look for her. But I'll be like, but I don't even know her. So that, in a way, did put like a hatch on me.
Yeah.
For the Christian faith, and. So I was having this conversation with Brian, and I say to Brian, you know, my mom sort of had as a pastor, but the reason that she's never bothered to come and look for us and all that really puts me on a back foot for the Christian faith. And so Brian was like, but your mom, who is your mom? And I was like, she uses the name Pastor Sarah Morgan. And Brian was like, Pastor Sarah Morgan?
As in he knew her?
Yes. He said, Pastor Sarah Morgan? Does she live in California? I said, so I've been told. Brian's like, I know Pastor Sarah Morgan. And Brian said, my mom is a friend to Pastor Sarah Morgan. I was like, excuse me? He said, yes. She's Ugandan. I said, excuse me? He said, yes.
So you were just speaking. You didn't know there was any relationship.
Nothing. And I had been close to Brian for the longest time ever.
Wow.
Brian Walusimbi. Coolest guy in the world. And the guy says, my mom is a friend to Pastor Sarah Morgan. And Brian says, I'm going to contact my mom and tell my mom this. And Brian did contact his mom, and his mom contacted me, and we spoke on the phone, and his mom was amazed. And the mom said, I need to see you. I need to video call you and see you. And she video called me. And the first thing she said to me was, my God, you look exactly like your mom. I was like, okay.
So what? As far as you knew, had your mother ever tried to look for you?
No.
Did people know that she had children?
No. She'd been married to another man with two babies. So
what happened next?
Fast forward. I say, I want to meet her. Brian's mom says, okay, I'll try all efforts to see that you meet her, but I need to talk to her and see what's her take on this. And he had a conversation with her. And Brian's mom called me back and said, I think she wants to see you. But she's not certain that she wants to see you. It was really strange. Fast forward. I got into contact with a lady called Susan. Susan Gwakav. She's Rwandese but Ugandan raised. And Susan goes to my mom's church. And Susan got so interested in this whole story, and she got so up close to me. She became a dear friend, and she said, you know what, when you're ready to come to California, come to my home and I organize this meet. And I organized it, flew to California, first flew to Minneapolis, told my big brother Tony Suvikalu about this.
He was there?
He lives in Minneapolis.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
With his family.
Mm-hmm.
Tony was like, tell Susan to call me.
Did he know that she was there?
Yeah, he knew. Tony was like, tell Susan to call me. So Susan called Tony. They had a long chat. And Tony was like, you know, these two don't really know each other. So I'm not sure what is bound to happen from here. But Tony gave me clear instructions of what should be done.
Okay.
Because I was more like meeting a total stranger anyway.
Okay.
At the end of the day. So I flew from Minneapolis to California, went to Susan's home, and after 2 days, Susan took me to a place like this and said, she's coming. And she came. Sat right next to me like the way you are. I was so baffled. I didn't know what to say.
How old were you?
I was angry.
Hmm.
I had lots of mixed feelings. But one thing you should know, of all the mixed feelings that I had, I was not excited.
You were not excited to see her? So you were just doing it just because what? You just needed to meet her?
I just needed to see this person. Like, for once, see this person and see. What's up? Like, what's up? Yeah.
How old were you?
I'm telling you a story of about 5 years ago. Like 5 years ago.
You said you were angry.
Yeah.
And I think we can all understand.
Yeah, I was. I mean, of all the things that I've gone through, of all the struggles that I've gone through, of all the challenges, of all, so many things, and I'm thinking, where have you been? Like, what's up with you? Like, my very first question to her was, did you forget that you gave birth? Do people forget that they give birth? That's what I wanted to know. Like, she said no. I said, did you think we were dead? Okay, in the event that we were dead, would you ever bother to come and see where we were laid to rest? Like, I had so many questions, because if I hadn't made this move, were you ever going to make this kind of move?
Didn't you want to meet me? Didn't you want to meet us?
That was like my hardest 2 hours of my lifetime. Hardest 2 hours of my lifetime. And I said, you know what, I need to go. She said, where? I said, back to Minneapolis, and I'm going back to Uganda.
Is that where it ended?
She said, we need to make this up and stop. And it is a lot. And I said to her, does your husband know? She said, no. So I said, so you've been hiding this from your husband for the longest, how long? You have two children. Do they know they have brothers? He said no. Well, I said, of all the things you've done, I'm going to outdo you by letting your husband know. And I did.
How did you do that?
I told him on the phone.
You called him?
Yeah. And I told him. He could not believe it. He could not believe it. Such a strong man of God. He could not believe it. And that was it. She tried to play the comeback game when I was back here, sending money, sending this and that. And my brother was not amused at all. My bigger brother is called David. I tried to ask him. I told him everything that unfolded, and I told him, do you want to talk to her? He said no. He said three or four times she would call occasionally and say, I'm sending you $1,000. I'm sending you $800. I'm sending you, this is for David. And David refused to take the money.
He didn't want to know.
After it had arrived here, he said, and I slowly stopped communicating. I slowly stopped texting back, and we've gone back to that.
So there's no relationship.
When I told my dad the story, my dad just said, I don't want to hear from her side. Let her be.
She left.
Let her be.
You know, I'm sad to say this, but normally you hear about this from men, you know, who just move on and forget about their children. It's very rare that you hear about it from women. So, how are you handling that?
Handling what exactly?
That.
The aftermeet or...
Because now you met her. I don't think you ever got any answers. Because you went looking for answers. You didn't get answers.
No. All I did get was the defensive side of her.
This is someone who's also not taking responsibility for what she did.
The defensive side of her. 99% of my conversation with her from her side was, your dad this, blah, 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 your dad, blah, 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 your father, blah, 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 your dad, da, 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 your dad, da, 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 your dad, da. As in why she had to leave and forsake her family and children. But you know, I grew up with my dad. Up to today, my father's never told me a thing about my mom. My father has never sat me down to tell me that your mom did A, B, C, D, E, F, G, H, I, J.
Says a lot about him.
So when I came back, I told him, Mommy said, he was there taking coffee. And after all that, he said, after I told him, I did not edit anything. And after that, my dad said, that's what she said? I said, yes. And my dad said, okay. Did she give you my money? I said, what money? He said, because when she was leaving, she carried $15,000 from my bedroom. Did she give it to you? I said, no. He said, okay. He said, welcome back. I was like, so what? She said, is there any truth in it? And he said, Some of it. That's where your sisters come from. And I asked my father, how about your side? Can you give me her side of her foes? And my dad said to me, it's not going to change a thing. You're a man now. It's not going to change a thing. I said, maybe she was an angel. He said, no. But what is it going to change if I tell you?
I mean, there are always two sides to a story. But I feel that your dad's attitude maybe also helped you just let it go.
He never discussed anything with us. And he raised us to be the men we are today.
Are you still angry?
No. I am past that.
Okay.
I am past that.
Has that affected, like, your relationships over time?
Not really.
You ever thought about it?
Not really.
No?
No.
Okay.
Not really. I would still want my dad to tell me at least a little bit of her side.
Maybe one day.
If the chance avails itself.
Maybe one day, when you're older.
Because I've had stories from my bigger brothers, from uncles and aunties.
Oh, so other people have kind of given you the
picture. Yeah, like, you know, her tough side. Some have talked about her manners, some have talked about her what. But I want to get it firsthand.
From him.
From the man who was with her in the bedroom.
I don't think he's going to share it. Maybe later.
He's just never.
Okay. Whew. Wow. Right?
And she's still there. She's still a pastor.
So.
Big church.
She's still a pastor. Has a following.
Oh, yes. Very big church. Very big church.
And people don't know this.
No. Part of my conversation with her was coming from her side. She said, this must stay discreet. That's when I walked out.
Okay. Okay. Well, your father raised you. Your father was there for you.
A million times. He's the only man that I've grown to know.
Okay.
And me and my dad are cool as ice. We're cool as vanilla. I walk into my father's bedroom and I would say, do you have a dope shirt?
Mm-hmm.
Do you have a perfume that I can take? He says, choose one. Oh. I choose that. He says, I like that one. Choose this.
So you're cool.
We are cool as vanilla.
That's nice.
And the whole family
mm-hmm.
stands at ease.
Okay.
Yeah.
So when you were talking about working at Sway as a barman, before that, were you in promotions before that?
No.
So straight from school, what happened?
Hustle and Basel.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Hustle and Basel.
So you finished high school?
Yeah.
Started the hustle life?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Properly.
Mm-hmm.
Properly.
Did you know what you wanted to do then?
Nah. No. Not at all. My bigger brother had a small, I don't even want to call it a boutique, because it was more like a corridor,
mm-hmm.
like a closet.
Mm-hmm.
For clothes and secondhand clothes and jeans and t-shirts and you know, those things. So he would go do the shopping and then, you know, arrange the closet and stuff, and then he would leave me there to run it by the day.
Ah, yeah. What was this?
It was at Zainabo Aziza Emporia. Mm-hmm. You know that place that has the Uhuru restaurant where people go for food,
yes,
for pilau?
Uh-huh.
The very last small closet.
In that corridor that goes,
yes,
down.
Mm-hmm. That's it.
Okay.
Yeah, so that's where I would be every day.
Mm-hmm.
Wilson Road.
Okay.
Yeah.
Ah, so it explains a bit about your style. Because I've always seen, I'm like,
You're stalking
me. Do you have a stylist?
You're
like
eyeing
that?
Me. Who's eyeing me? Yeah?
Okay.
Yeah, a little bit. Mm-hmm. A little bit. Yeah.
So, were you working there when you started working at Sway?
Yes.
Uh-huh.
Yes, I was. There's a certain gentleman, it's called Henry Chamber. Henry Chamber is into entertainment. He's a big time player into entertainment, has equipment and stuff. So I was friends with him, family friends from Ginger. So one time I was talking to him and he told me, you know, Rajiv is opening up a bar. He's opening up a bar and I'm the one supplying the equipment. I could take you and recommend you. I said, please take me. Henry Chamber, and he took me there.
And that got you in.
And that's how I made the flip from the shop to the bar.
But now how did you make the flip from the bar to TV?
Now how I make the flip from the bar to TV is after Rajiv had elevated me from the bar to the booth.
Ah.
Now I started working on figuring my speech and figuring my delivery. And figuring how, you know, to talk to the public and community and how to execute and all that came into play. And then Chameleon started taking me to stages. He started saying, this guy is the one that opens for me.
Mm.
And then I started going to like stage after stage after stage. People started seeing me for concerts. And then that's how I officially became the official MC for Leon Island.
Mm.
So every time I would go, people would identify me, oh, your MC were Chameleon, MC were Chameleon. I'd go to a point where if there was a concert or a performance and I appear, then people would know, Doug, yes, Chameleon. Chameleon
he's
is
around. He's here.
Chameleon is somewhere around here, Adja. Chameleon is going to perform. If you see Doug, you know Chameleon. So he sold me to the public eye. And then people started seeing my potentials and my capabilities. And people started recognizing what I could do and, you know, maybe what I could bring to the table. And just like that, I cross roads with the man called J.K. Kazora.
Kazora.
And Kazora says to me, I remember it was a rainy day. He was driving from the gym at Hotel Africana and I saw him and I was standing at Total right opposite Hotel Africana and he was stuck in traffic. So I saw him because it was raining, I was taking shelter.
Mm.
But then I saw him, I spotted him. And then I said, this guy. I ran through the rain and knocked on the door, it was raining. I told him, I called you 10 times and you never take my calls. And he was like, I don't have your number. And you know, traffic is moving and I'm in the rain. I'm saying, I need to talk to you. He said, send me a message right now. It's raining in the car. And I was like, it's raining on me. I'm outside the car, but you're worried about.
I was talking to him through the window.
Yeah, and he's moving slowly and he says, call me again. Send me a message and say your name. He pulled the window and I ran back. And I sent him a message and said, hey, Dougie here. Please pick my calls again. He called me the next day. He says, what's up? What's up? I said, I need you to give me some jigs. I just can't be doing stage all the time.
Mm.
I need to give me some jigs. And he said, okay. He said, you come over to my place and I see what you can do. He put me in front of a camera like I am in front of your camera right now. He gave me a script to read. I did about 10 takes. He came back, he went through them, he said, you keep doing this. I did it again. And then after like 3 months of me doing nothing with him, just there on a chill, like, on a guy, Yamvako, no, no guy in those. I am back. I think I didn't pass what he wanted.
Mm.
He gave me a call and he said, you go to the Airtel house, meet somebody called Musa Mayanja and tell him you're from me. There's a promotion they want to do. So go there right now and they're waiting for you.
Okay.
I go meet the guy and they say, so you're the guy from Kazora, yeah. Okay, we are going to do a promotion called ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta. We want you to be the face of the promotion. That was my first appearance on promotions. And I executed so well. And after the promo was done for 4 months, Kazora came back to me and said, my son, you did well. You've been given a new contract. You're doing another promotion for Airtel. I said, okay. And as I started appearing on TV, those promotions. And for close to about, I think, 4 years, I was just doing Airtel promotions. Then MTN came for me, then Sutherland came for me, then MultiChoice came for me. Then after people realized that I had the potential to sell a product.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And that's how I became the promotions king of TV in Uganda.
Okay.
Now, interestingly enough, because the first promotion was running on NTV, it was running through a program called Exposed, hosted by MC Katz.
Yes.
So the requirement was we need the brand ambassador of this campaign to appear on Exposed every Saturday because MC Katz did not have, you know, the idea of what the campaign was all about. So given that I had the whole idea, they said you have to appear on that show and run it with Katz for 45 minutes every Saturday.
So because of the client, the promotion, that's how you started doing TV every weekend?
Yes.
With him?
Yes, yes.
Mm-hmm.
So every Saturday I would be there. And then because it was sponsored by Airtel, so it required me to be there. So it transcended from me being there to MC Katz getting comfortable and saying, Dougie, today I'm not coming.
Oh.
So will you help me run the whole show?
So sometimes you do the show on your own?
Yes, like a million times I did it alone. Like a million times. And so after the campaign was done, my boss then, Agi Konde, when the campaign was done, I went to say thank you for the time. And Agi said, I'd love to retain you. I said, excuse me, ma'am. She said, I'd love to retain you. I think you're good on air talent.
This came as a surprise to you?
Yes.
What?
Yes. I mean, I'd never seen myself, like, getting the
so
grand...
it was just happening, but you never really saw it?
No. No. Because I was just, you know, this promotions guy. Just come in, sell a product for 4 months. What are we doing? We're giving out cars. We're giving out houses. We're giving out... sell that product.
Mm.
Ask people to buy airtime. Ask people to load as much airtime as they can. Those things.
So you were comfortable in that role. You didn't see yourself being on TV.
No.
Right.
No.
Hmm.
Yeah. So, you know when you are in that space of, like on a Friday night, you have a jig, but then again, you don't want to stretch it because, you know tomorrow I'm on TV. I have this promotion. You know those things.
Uh-huh.
I have to look sober. My eyes are red and, you know, all those things. So it was... I'm just going in there for 45 minutes and walk out. And wait for next Saturday. 45 minutes and walk out. And go do my other things. Stage things and stuff. And Agi Konde said, I would like to retain you. Let's discuss.
This was, what, 2014?
Yeah. She said, I'm going to give you a contract. And I'm going to keep you on the show. I said, what show, ma'am? She said, Exposed. I said, me and Kat. She said, yes. Yes. Now the two of you are going to do the show. Fully.
Do you love TV?
I do. Not as much as back then. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. I think this is the law of diminishing returns working on me now.
Okay.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So... then, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Then you had the energy and the,
yeah,
the drive
now,
and the concerts and the...
now it's has dawned on me that it's actually a job.
Mm. Yeah. Do you think the pandemic had something to do with that as well?
on the good side of it, the bad side of it?
Like, because everything came to a stop.
Yeah.
And, you know, the concerts, the hype kind of came to a stop.
And the pandemic made us 10 times more busy. Because then the country just turned to TV. And
it was up to you.
Yeah. Yeah. And then you know, management, you know, structured these shows that we're doing all night, Friday nights and Saturday nights, dance party.
Asking so much more of you.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And mix show. And, you know, normally, usually here, we do TV for 2 hours daily.
Yes.
And that's it. And now they're asking you to do TV for 2 hours. And then after 2 hours, come back and do TV for 10 hours.
That's crazy.
Yeah.
I don't think people really fully grasp.
Yes.
How big that is.
Yes.
And how much that takes.
Yes. Yes. A lot of work.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of work.
It's work.
Yeah. Because now, you know, the difference here is that it's a lot easier for somebody who is on the couch to judge somebody who is on the screen.
Yeah.
You've been there, you know. 10 times easier. For someone to say, I don't like Christo. Someone to say, Christo doesn't know how to dance. Christo doesn't know how to talk. Christo doesn't know how to host. Mm. Christo doesn't know how to... It's because they're on the couch. If ever they were asked to switch places and tell them, come and do what
you do it. Doing.
Yeah. You will actually... That's when they'll actually give you your flowers. That's when they'll say, you know what, Christo, come back to you. Yeah, I'll pass.
That's very, very
yeah.
true.
Yeah, so it's hard. And people think it's easy. People think it's fun. But
to be good, to be consistent, man, it's a lot. You put a lot into it.
Yes.
Mm.
It doesn't come easy. People look at you and they don't know that. After you say, thank you for being a beautiful audience, we'll see you next weekend. Like as an example, me, I do Friday nights. And when you do Friday nights, the NTV mix show, you do a Friday night. And once you're done and you say, we'll see you next Friday, tomorrow dance party is coming in. They don't know that on Saturday, your whole feet are in a bucket of ice.
Mm. Yeah, because you've been on your feet.
They don't know that you are just like that.
Exhausted
they don't know that when you want to go to pick a drink you actually walk like.
Wow.
You know.
Mm.
They have no idea. They don't know that after that your back is on fire. You're like dying. You know.
Yeah.
And you know. Some will still not give you the flowers. Some will say,
That is so real.
That's
the work that goes into it. And then you make it look easy, so that's why everyone thinks.
Exactly.
Anyone can do it.
Exactly.
Mm-hmm.
Then again. Exactly.
Tell me about your little girl. How old is she now?
Emma, she's 6.
She's 6?
Yeah, she's adorable. She's so grown.
She's with the mom. You are in a long distance marriage.
Yes.
Uh-huh.
We are.
How did you meet?
Yeah.
How did you meet?
I was in Jinja at Kingfisher.
Kingfisher, okay.
Yeah, again, concerts.
Okay.
And then we slept at Kingfisher and we'd gone for breakfast. And as we're having breakfast, they were also having breakfast from across the table. There were like 5 of them. And I spotted her. She was looking all sexy and nice. She was in a bikini. And again, that other part of me escaping from school. You know.
Mm-hmm.
They serve you and you said, are these eggs? Eh? Mm. Is this tomato sauce? Yes, it's tomato sauce.
Uh-huh.
Hey. Mm. Yeah. That part there, you ask someone, this is lemon, eh? With soda. You say, hey. It's for drinking. Yes, it's for drinking. Okay.
Uh-huh.
I'm going to drink. Yeah, so, you know, you're serving your breakfast and you're looking at this lady and I'm thinking, okay, these are eggs, eh? Ah, okay.
Mm-hmm.
This is a fork. Okay. And this knife? For eating, eh?
Okay, totally confused.
Totally confused.
Totally.
Yeah. And
okay.
I walked up to her. I timed her when she was walking to the counter.
Mm-hmm.
I said, it's now or never. I walked up to her and said, hi, how are you? She said, fine, thank you. Hi. I said, my name is Douglas. She said, my name is Heather. I said, I just wanted to say, my God, you are beautiful. She said, I noticed you were staring at me.
He wasn't even cool about it, man. She saw it.
And I said, and she said, you know what? I could give you my card. You can call me and say hello. And
so, was she living in Uganda or was she here on holiday?
She was here on a study holiday.
Okay. Okay.
Yeah, and she was, you know, she's a pharmacist professionally.
Mm-hmm.
So she was here to do something with Mulago Hospital as a volunteer.
Ah.
Yeah. And then, you know, one hello led to another hello, and the other hello led to a million hellos, and then one meet led to another meet. Dinner, lunch, hangouts, drink ups. After about 6 weeks, we became close.
Mm-hmm.
And the rest was history.
Okay. So how long after you met did you get married?
Oh,
you dated how long?
Like 6 months.
Okay. Okay.
6 months, close to seven, sliding into eight probably.
Okay.
Yeah.
So long distance. I know we need to wrap up, but
yeah.
Long distance. A lot of people are scared of long distance. How is that?
First and foremost, I think one of the biggest challenges has been that the country that she comes from is one of the most strict countries on planet Earth, Australia.
Yeah.
I'm sure you know that yourself.
They lock down. Mm-hmm.
Actually, Australia is the only country, I think, in the world that did bar its citizens from coming in, but they decided to give them government support. From
wherever they were.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
For a classic 2 years. So however much I wanted to even fly in and go and see them and see baby and see her and stuff, there was just no way. We wrote letters to the embassy and all that, but I was no exception. Yeah. So I had, you know, to stroll a whole 2 years without going in.
I hope you see each other soon.
I'm praying we do. Thank you.
Oh, Dougie, thank you for joining me.
I'm very humbled. Still excited to be with you.
Well, I've laughed. I've had a good time. Good. Really good.
I just realized I didn't ask you how you were.
Hey.
Yeah.
You asked me before, but I am good. I am blessed.
You look amazing.
Thank you.
I also have a question for you.
Hey.
Yeah.
Okay.
Something I've always wanted to ask you. What does it take for somebody to be this alive in doing what you do? How do you stay happy? How do you keep the happy smiles? For the longest time that I've seen you and followed you and admired you and adored you, you have stayed the same Crystal. How do you stay relevant? How do you stay alive? Not just for me, but for the 1 million girls that are gonna be watching this.
Look at you interviewing me at the end of my show.
Then again, I'm a TV presenter.
I know, I was expecting this. No, honestly, I think it's just love for what you do. I find things that I'm passionate about. I'm passionate about people. I do things that make sense to me and who I am. I try not to pretend.
Yeah.
I try to be myself as much as possible. And man, life has so many positive things. People like to focus on the negatives. People like scandal, they like drama, they like toxic. But if you focus on the positives, I mean, they give you life.
Wow. Amazing. Well, guess what? I'm going to take after you.
Mm-hmm.
And focus on the positives.
Focus on the positives.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Sure.
For joining me.
I'm Mohammed. Thank you for inviting me.